of St. John Berchmans. Welcome to our 7th and 8th graders, some of our confirmation students, and also our RCIA candidates and catechumens, and some of you who are our regular adult faith formation individuals. A special welcome, obviously, though, to the Archbishop. Archbishop Alfred Hughes was the Archbishop of New Orleans, and before that was Bishop of Baton Rouge. He was the bishop who ordained Bishop Duca about 12 years ago. Some of you may have been there, the big convention center, like 3,000 plus people there for that beautiful, wonderful occasion. We're now praying for the third bishop in another big ceremony there in the same place, perhaps. Bishop Hughes was also here when Bishop Friend died and was present for his funeral service, which was in April 2015. Bishop Hughes, Archbishop Hughes, has written books on the topic of prayer, is currently at Notre Dame Seminary in New Orleans, and we're very fortunate to have him as part of our Lex Orandi, Lex Credendi semester here at the Adult Faith Formation of the Cathedral of St. John Berchmans. Thank you so much for being here, Archbishop.
Thank you again, Father Peter, for your warm welcome, all the services you have rendered, and again, I truly appreciate the way in which you are shepherding the diocese while awaiting a new shepherd. I'm not your good bishop.
We'll take it.
I'm over the hill. You wouldn't want someone my age. Join you in prayer for your new bishop. I think it's important that we do pray for him, whoever he may be, and pray as well that together you can be that expression of God's church that he wants us to be. It's a delight to be here with you this morning, and thank you for coming in such numbers to participate in this. I do want to focus this morning on how we might approach extended quiet prayer, addressing some of the challenges and difficulties, opening ourselves to God's Word, responding to him. We know the disciples of the Lord Jesus observed how Jesus prayed, and motivated by the evident fruitfulness of prayer in his life, they approached him pleadingly. Lord, teach us how to pray. And it was at that time Jesus taught them the prayer that we've come to call the Lord's own prayer. And we could spend a whole morning just breaking open the contents of the Lord's prayer. This request on the part of the disciples of Jesus was not necessarily because they were not trying to pray. They sensed that their attempts at prayer were not bearing the fruit that they would like to see. Does that sound familiar? We have to begin with a presumption. Jesus not only is our Lord and Savior, but because he fully embraced our human nature, he also is a model for prayer for us. As I mentioned in the homily, if you were present at the 8 o'clock Mass, he prayed at the synagogue every week. In whatever town he was located in, he went to the temple in Jerusalem for the major feasts. What seemed to attract the attention of the disciples was the way in which solitary prayer impacted the way in which he spoke and lived. Notice some of the teachings that Jesus offered to his disciples. When you pray, go into your inner room. I'm talking about a physical inner room in a house, but the inner sanctum of our soul. He urged his disciples to pray persistently. Remember the parable of the poor widow seeking justice? He urged us to pray always. That doesn't mean explicitly engaging in prayer, but being in communion with him as we live and act. And he enjoined us to pray confidently, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will be opened to you. And you know, there are two accounts of that, one in Matthew, one in Luke. And Luke, I think, helps us to truly appreciate what it is that Jesus most wanted us to pray for. When he invited us to ask and seek and knock. He gave two examples of, you know, if you are good parents and your child asks you for bread, you don't give them stone, or fish, you don't give them a scorpion. And then Jesus went on to say, how much more does your heavenly Father want to give you the Holy Spirit if you ask him? That's what's important. Begging for the Holy Spirit so that we then know what it is God is asking us to say or do as we address the challenges. What I'd like to do is to talk about three basic movements to pay attention to if we're going to enter into deeper prayer. Quieting the heart, listening with the mind, and then responding with the will. Now, let's begin with a premise. In Christian prayer, God is the initiator, not us. We have a tendency to think that the burden of prayer depends upon our taking the initiative. But as Christians, we believe that God has spoken and is continuing to speak. And so the posture that we want to assume in prayer is one of listening. However, we need first to quiet the heart. You know, as soon as we begin to turn off all of the external sources of noise, the radio, the TV, Satan loves to discourage us from sustaining quiet prayer because he's terribly afraid of our hearing the Word of God. And so it's incredibly important that we work our way through the quieting process as we begin to pray. Now, as we begin to become aware of what's surfacing, it's helpful to pay attention to what it is that's going on there. What's inevitably happening is the concerns of our life are coming into focus. That's what we begin to experience surfacing after we've quieted the external noise. Now, what is important here is not so much the thoughts that surface, but the drives, the emotions behind those thoughts. As I was praying this morning, I experienced a concern about what I was going to say, how I was going to handle this session with you. What was that expressive of? My anxiety to do well. Well, it's important to appreciate what is behind the concern that persistently begins to surface, and then bring that to God. Lord, it's not important what I'm going to say. What is important is that the people who come hear what you want them to hear. That's a way of diminishing the anxiety and allowing ourselves interiorly to become a bit more quiet and then receptive. Sometimes we think of what begins to surface as distractions. Actually, there's signals about what's become important in our life that can be stumbling blocks to our being able to be present to God. Can we turn those stumbling blocks into stepping stones? Can we name what's going on, what the concerns are that persistently emerge within us? I may be concerned about something that happened yesterday that hurt me or is unresolved. Or I may be concerned about what's coming up today. Can I name what's underneath the thoughts that are emerging? Bring that to God. Put it in His hands and beg for the grace to become more interiorly quiet and open to His Word. As the psalmist prays in Psalm 31, we need to become like a weaned child in his or her mother's lap. We want to move in a self-transcendent direction, handing over to God the concerns that are preoccupying us. They're going to be there at the end of insight. What is it that God is trying to say to me? Maybe events in my life, or what is usually most helpful, is to use the inspired text of sacred scripture, that is the Word of God. I encourage you to think in terms of securing one of those daily missalets that has the scripture readings for each day. The church has already identified the most important readings for us to pray over, to listen to. And over a 3-year cycle for Sunday readings, over a 2-year cycle for daily readings, we're exposed to every passage in sacred scripture that is significant for the living of a better Christian spiritual life. So, if we let the church be our spiritual director, the church has already suggested to us what might be helpful passages to pray over. Sometimes just related to the ordinary weeks of the year, and sometimes focused on the special seasons of the year, liturgically, Advent, Christmas, Lent, and Easter. We have already mentioned God takes the initiative in prayer. If we have quieted down, then I encourage you to pick up the text. With the daily readings, there are two scriptural passages offered every day. One is either an Old Testament passage, or one of the pastoral epistles of the Acts of the Apostles from the New Testament. The other is always a reading from one of the four Gospels. Look at them quickly and decide which one you'd like to focus on. And then begin to read as slowly as you can. Experience the reading as hearing the words being spoken by God. Remember, the letter to Hebrews says, the scriptural word is living, like a two-edged sword. It is intended to penetrate between the marrow and the bones. It's a living word. So if we read the passage we've decided to focus on slowly, even mouth the words, if that helps us to experience them as being spoken to us. And when a word, or a verse, or a whole line begins to strike us, pause. Why does it begin to strike us? Because there's a relationship between God's word and what's happening in our lives. Something is clicking. We want to pause and let that phrase, that verse, sink in. Dwell with it. Ponder it. purpose of pondering is to go below the surface for its deeper meaning. And it's also intended to lead to letting it seep down from mind to heart, which is very important for them incorporating it into life. Now, the Catechism of the Catholic Church speaks of both a literal sense of sacred scripture and a spiritual sense of sacred scripture. The literal sense is the obvious meaning of the words intended by the human author, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Every text also has spiritual meanings, and the Catechism spells out three possible spiritual meanings, and don't let official words describing those spiritual meanings discourage you. The first is allegorical. Now that does not mean metaphorical. What it means is that there are passages in one portion of Scripture that are foreshadowed in earlier books of sacred scripture. That's why the scripture always needs to be interpreted in light of the whole. What is foreshadowing the prophecies? What is foreshadowing some of the Psalms? What is even foreshadowed in some of the historical events, like the passage through the Red Sea, the experience of the people of old moving their way through the desert till they came to the Promised Land. All of that is fulfilled on a deeper and richer level in Christ Jesus. All of sacred scripture ultimately has to be interpreted in light of Christ Jesus. He is the one word of the Father. So all of the inspired words are just offering us little insights, little glances into the one divine word made in flesh, revealing what the Father wants us to know and live in life. So, the allegorical spiritual meaning is when we see a link. Now, if you pay attention to the special season in the church year, not the ordinary weeks of the year. Advent, Christmas, Lent, Easter. There's going to be a relationship between the first reading and the gospel passage. The first reading is going to prepare for the content of the gospel. In the ordinary weeks of the year, we just have a continuous reading from both an Old Testament book or one of the pastoral epistles. And in the Gospel, we have a continuous reading as well. So then, the church is not explicitly trying to relate the two, but in the special seasons of the year which touch the most important mysteries of our faith, those are the ones that were foreshadowed in the Old Testament and came to full completion in the New Testament. So that's what we mean by the allegorical spiritual sense of Scripture. Unpacking that, appreciating that. Secondly, the spiritual meaning is a moral meaning. That means that the text has immediate implications for the living of life today. Not restricted to a particular time, but perennially true and important to hear and apply in life. That's probably the easiest one, spiritual meaning, for us to unpack once we recognize the literal meaning of the text. And the third spiritual meaning that the Catechism identifies for us is a term called the anagogical spiritual meaning. Now, anagogical comes from a Greek word, and all it means is that the meaning of this text is also pointing to a fulfillment in the life to come. Anagoge means on the way to the future. So the spiritual meanings either are looking back to the way in which God's word was foreshadowed in imperfect ways in the past and has come to fulfillment in Christ. Or its immediate application for today, or looking to a greater fulfillment in the life to come. Notice how that captures the whole biblical vision of life and relates our life to the life of Christ, who is not only Savior, but paradigm, model for what it means to live the fullness of life in this world. This is the second and, of course, in a real sense, this is where prayer truly begins. The first movement is clearing the deck so we can hear. But in the second movement, we're letting the Word of God speak. We're receiving it, as Paul said, in delight, as he wrote in his letter to the Thessalonians, "You received the word I spoke, as it really is, the word of God." That's what this second movement is about. Now, the third movement, responding with the word. We want to make sure that we're not just intellectually pondering God's word. Remember what Jesus said, what St. James echoed in his letter? What profit does it make if we claim to know God's word? So, responding with the will is moving from insight into response. First, interior response, and then after prayer, the way we live. Now, in living out the Christian moral life, we often hear teaching of the church and struggle maybe with some dimensions of that teaching. It's only when we begin begins to become manifest in our lives. When from within, we desire to live out what we've heard, what we've come to appreciate, what God is inviting or challenging us to look at in our lives. The response needs to be affective. Now, when I use the term affective, I'm not just talking about emotion. Emotion may be there or it may not be there. Remember, I'm calling this movement responding with the will. But affect is rooted ultimately in desire. And desire is the motivating force in life. In that first movement of prayer, we were identifying some of the concerns that may be at work in our lives. There may be desires at work in our lives that are competing with God. But in this third movement, we're activating the deepest desire, the desire for God, and the desire to respond to Him and to His Word. And from within, I can remember, I don't know how many of you may be familiar with a directed retreat. Personally directed retreat is a retreat that isn't preached. But each day you go in to a spiritual, personal spiritual work. And he begins by offering you some suggested scriptural passages to pray over. And then you come in and share with him, or with her, what has transpired in your prayer. And the spiritual director then begins to give some feedback and will suggest further scriptural passages to pray over the next 24 hours. Well, when I began making personally directed retreats, I remember coming in and the spiritual director said to me, "Well, Al, you're coming up with some good insights into sacred scripture. But what are you saying in response?" And he was so concerned about that, he finally got me writing a response in prayer, because my prayer was more intellectual than it was affect, moving desire to action. I'll be forever grateful to that retreat director that nudged me into that. Remember that this response is possible because the Holy Spirit has been given to us. It is the Holy Spirit that makes possible both our hearing and our responding to God's Word. That's why we want to recognize that the Holy Spirit given to us, as I mentioned in the homily, initially in baptism, and then in greater portion in the sacrament of confirmation, you are preparing to receive the Holy Spirit in confirmation. We have a claim that we have received the Holy Spirit. We have a claim on the Holy Spirit to help us both hear and respond. points that may be important to make before I open it up for your own comments, questions. Notice what we're talking about here is the way in which the Church invites us to pray in the Eucharist. At the beginning, we're invited to pause in the introductory rites. What's even more important is that we've begun to quiet ourselves before Mass begins. That we come early and provide an opportunity to begin to go through that first movement. When the celebrant invites us to recall our sins that we might more worthily celebrate the sacred mysteries, that's not just a routine introduction. What the celebrant is inviting is that we quiet down, begin to be aware of what's going on in our lives, and where we need further redemptive grace. Because in the Mass, the redemption is going to be made present again in sacrament. So the first movement is to quiet down and become aware of what it is that needs the touch of God's grace. An increased share in the redemptive grace he offers. The second movement is the liturgy of the word. That's when we're invited to listen to God's word. St. Augustine, interestingly enough, invites even the celebrant who may have already prepared a homily to be attentive to the public proclamation of the word, because God may reveal in the public proclamation of the word something he wants his people to hear. I encourage you, before coming to Mass, to look at the scriptural readings. It will predispose you to letting the public proclamation speak more powerfully to you. The third movement of the Eucharist is what we call the liturgy of the sacrament, beginning with the presentation of the gifts, moving to the Eucharistic prayer, culminating in Holy Communion. Happening? Well, we're bringing the bread and wine that are brought forward in the name of the congregation is intended to be a symbolic expression of the ordinary bread and the extraordinary wine in our lives that we want to unite them as the Eucharistic prayer makes present Christ in his body and blood, offering himself to the Father for our salvation and sanctification. We want to bring ourselves, our lives, with everything that's going on with him to the Father. And we want to bring whatever may have been the special insight that came from listening to his word that might shed light on how we want to live out responding. We want to bring that to the Father with him by virtue of the gift of the Holy Spirit. And if that is going on, then we accept his gift of himself. and invite him to stay with us, that we live in communion with him as we go forth to live on what we've come to appreciate and immerse ourselves in at the Mass. Notice, too, that this, what we're talking about here, is reflective of the Trinitarian God. God the Father is the origin of all that is. He's the one that has given direction, purpose to all of creation. When we quiet down, we want to be in touch with the Father. We want to crawl into the lap of the Father. We want, as we quiet down, to become more centered, to have the ultimate purpose, direction of our lives become more clear. When we listen to the Word in the second movement, these words are reflective of the divine Word, the Lord Jesus himself, become flesh. And when we respond, we're responding because the Holy Spirit makes that possible. And the Holy Spirit is the eternal gift of the Father to the Son and the Son to the Father. The Holy Spirit makes possible our response to the Father, expressed in the way in which we live with one another. Finally, let me invite you to look at the passage from St. Matthew in the page that is entitled Lectio Divina. On that day, Jesus went out of the house and sat down by the sea. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood along the shore. And he spoke to them at length in parables, saying, "A soul went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell in the path, and birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. But when the sun rose, it was scorched, and it withered for lack of roots. Some seed fell among thorns. The thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil and produced fruit 100 or 60 or 30-fold. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The apostles apparently considered this to be an extraordinarily important parable of Jesus. It's one of two parables that they quote Jesus' own interpretation of the parable for their benefit when they were alone with him. And what does Jesus say? but it can't take root. And when the first difficulty comes, challenge to live out the word. Because there's no root, the word is let go of. If the word delights us, we're happy. But when we experience difficulty, we let go. Some seed falls among thorns. What are the thorns? Those are the competing gods in our life. Desire for wealth, power, comfort, prestige, self-gratification. It can be any number of competing gods in our life. The seed initially takes root, begins to grow, but then as it comes into contact with the thorns, it gets choked. The competing desires in our life choke out the fundamental desire for God. Whereas the seed that falls on good soil bears fruit. Now, I begin to enter into that last category when I already identify myself in one of the previous categories, or a combination of them. That's when the seed, the Word of God, begins to bear fruit. Let me stop there and invite questions, comments, observations, difficulties.
Father mentioned you had some books. Can you tell us the titles?
Well, one is called Formation for Church Ministry.
Okay.
And that addresses for both those preparing for ordained ministry and lay ministry the issues that are important to address. I also have a book called The Spiritual Masters that looks at the whole Christian spiritual journey, and each chapter unpacks a building block in that journey, but each chapter also invites the reader to see how one of the spiritual, Christian spiritual classics helps us to appreciate that stepping stone in the journey. So I begin with the need to introduce quiet time. That's the beginning of taking seriously the Christian spiritual life. If we don't introduce quiet time in our lives, it's impossible to grow. It's impossible to go deeper. Depth is dependent upon quiet. And not passive quiet, but engaged quiet. So I introduce the readers to some of the sayings of the Desert Fathers, who went into the desert for extended periods of time. Then the second chapter, I open up a map for the Christian spiritual journey, and I draw on Walter Hilton's scale of perfection. And then engagement in the conversion that we need to move into more fully and deeply. And I draw upon Augustine's confessions. And And then the positive movement of love. How does bringing self-giving love, not saccharine love, not sensual love, but self-giving love as the center of life, turn to inward or revolt? And then, if I'm going to live all of this out, I need to develop a pattern of life, a way of life. You know, the early Christians used to refer to one another as those who follow the way, meaning they had taken Jesus' way of life seriously. So we need to find a concrete way to enflesh the living out of what we've begun to enter into and cultivate what it may lead to. And I take Benedict and his rule of life as a way of doing that for one group of people and suggesting that we need to adapt that to our own living of life. And then focus on, as soon as we begin to take seriously the Christian spiritual life, begin to move through conversion, begin to grow in love, begin to adopt a new way of living, the devil is going to really try to dissuade us one way or another. And let's face it, we're involved in a spiritual battle. So I turn to the imitation of Christ to unpack that spiritual battle. And then I move more explicitly into prayer, drawing on Guigo II, the Carthusian. Actually, a lot of what I'm saying here comes from his teaching on how to move into extended prayer with the scriptural word. And then growth in prayer, I turn to Teresa of Avila and some of the insights that she offers. And then sacramental prayer with Catherine of Siena. And then the fruit of prayer, virtue. Prayer, if we want to realize whether the prayer we're entering into is genuine or not, we need to look at the fruit. Does it lead to virtue? Personal virtue, I turn to Francis de Sales. Social virtue, Ignatius of Loyola and his spiritual exercises. And then facing realistically suffering in life, the mystery of suffering, turn to John of the Cross. And then finally, the goal of life, moving toward the ultimate surrender that death is going to involve, but prepared by little surrenders in daily life. Jean-Pierre de Caussade and his abandonment to divine providence. So that's what that's about. Please. Did everybody hear that? This gentleman is asking for comment on the Jesus prayer, which has been fostered coming out of the desert experience, but also especially fostered in the Christian East, in the monastic tradition. The Jesus prayer is, Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, a sinner. And in the East, where they did not initially developed the rosary, developed in the West as a repetitive prayer. This was a repetitive prayer which was encouraged to be prayed at the same time as breathing in and breathing out. So breathing in, Jesus, the Son of God, and then breathing out, have mercy on me, a sinner. Consciously inviting the Savior in, explicitly wanting to give over our sins to Him. Now, repetitive prayer, and especially tied to breathing, deep breathing, is helpful for bringing greater quiet, helpful for providing a greater sense of harmony. Also, helps us to begin to move more deeply in life. And for people who are busy, that may be one of the helpful ways for them to go. It is important that at some point we develop a greater capacity to be quiet and not just dependent upon a repetitive prayer. The Jesus prayer can help foster that, but I wouldn't hang on to it indefinitely. Let it lead to the kind of interior quiet that allows us to be more receptive and responsive to the Word of God speaking to us. Is that helpful? Please. The question is how to continue to pray the rosary, which is a repetitive prayer, and handle the persistent distractions and preoccupations that enter in and make it difficult to concentrate. And some of the same things I'm just saying about the Jesus prayer applies here. Remember the origin of the rosary. The origin of the rosary is when people did not have access to the scriptures. They were publishing had not taken place, there were limited numbers of manuscripts. They are all written in the original languages, Hebrew, Greek, Latin. The origin of the rosary was to provide for lay people 150 ways of praying 150 psalms. So originally there were three sets of mysteries, totaling 150 Hail Marys. And what was behind this? purpose was to help people occupy their external senses by saying a repetitive prayer, consciously joining with Mary, but focusing attention on pondering the mysteries of faith. That's why each decade provides us with a different mystery to ponder, pray over. Now, there's nothing magical about praying the whole rosary. The rosary should be leading us, as the Jesus prayer, to greater quiet. I was very helped by Pope Benedict once saying, in connection with the rosary, he said that often he did not complete the rosary. He was not concerned about saying the whole rosary, but if pondering a mystery led him to greater quiet and engagement with the mystery, he stayed with that, even though time-wise, he then would not be able to finish the rosary. So that's a way of keeping it from being repetitive in the wrong way and keeping us just mouthing words and our mind someplace else. So I don't know whether that helps. Well, it's always a struggle for me. And yes, the question is, do you grow in a capacity to become more quiet? Yes. But is it always going to be a struggle? Yes. And I think the busier we are, the more responsibilities that we have in life, the more of a struggle is going to be. I can remember that before I was ordained a bishop, I was able to move into greater quiet than when I had many more responsibilities placed on my plate. Well, God placed the responsibilities there. So, I don't want to say it's my fault that I lost a capacity for greater quiet that was there before. But I still want to foster that as best I can. And often, I will have to keep coming back to the first movement in prayer after having entered into the second. I'm not suggesting that movement 1, 2, and 3 have to happen sequentially all the time. If, as I begin to read, I find myself distracted, I can move back into that first movement and try to identify what it is that's underneath the distraction, bring that to God, and then go back to listening. But for some people, it's going to be a constant struggle. And you know what I do when I spend a whole hour in prayer and nothing seems to have come into focus for me? I say to the Lord, "Lord, I'm not sure whether this is my fault, but please accept this time as an expression of suddenly that whole time is caught up as an act of love, even though it's been distracted the whole time. Don't give up because of distraction. Stay with it, but make sure before you conclude prayer that you saying something directly to God from the heart. And your will is moving toward wanting to live it out. The purpose of prayer is not communication. It's communion with God. And even if the prayer is consistently distracted, over a period of time, if we're faithful, quiet prayer, that's going to have an impact on our lives and the quality of our relationship with God. And we're going to find sometimes God speaks to us at unsuspecting moments. And because we have been struggling to develop an openness and receptivity to His Word, we've heard that word at an unsuspecting moment. We can't control when God is going to speak to us. Thanks for sharing that. Have we
I think we are out of
exhausted everybody?